This afternoon, as I sit out here and think about what I want to say for our opening today, it's raining. Can you hear that? That's good. Yesterday, it rained around here, and as I was driving home, the roads were wet and there was puddles. But right when I got close to our neighborhood, it was dry, and I was disappointed. There's just something about water, isn't there, that we like, that is good. You know, good clean water, right? It's a good thing to drink. It's very refreshing. You know, it talks about water a lot in Scripture. Psalm 23, he leads us beside quiet streams of water. Psalm 46, which a lot of us in class studied last Sunday, talks about that there's a river whose streams make glad the city of God. So there's this river running through the city of God. I think it means heaven. This river that runs through the middle of it, and everybody likes it, and it makes everybody glad. And like every time they see it, they say, "I like that. That's beautiful." You know, you can hear the thunder. Maybe I sometimes, if it's raining at night, I haven't been in bed very long, I'll get up. I get up. I want to see it. You know, our country has been in need of water. You know, particularly out west, you think about the fires that they are going through, and how much they would love to see some water. My uncle, you know, has some farmland down in Texas, in West Texas. It just seems like West Texas is almost always dry, and they're always wanting rain. Rain is such a good thing and such a blessing from God. You know, when you stop and think about it, we have a lot of blessings from God, don't we? You have a lot of blessings from God. I know life's not perfect, right? It's not. And a lot of people are going through some really tough things, and I'm not making light of that. But at the same time, it is nice sometimes just to sit out here where I can listen to the rain, and it's right close to the trees are just right there, and you can hear the rain hitting the trees, the leaves, and it's a great blessing from God. I think that's why so many of the psalmists would write about water. So let me lead us in a prayer here as we begin. Father, thank you for the rain today. The earth here needs it. And so we say thank you, Father. Thank you for the rain. Thank you for the many blessings that you shower upon us, Lord, and the ways that you show your love to us and your concern and your care. And Lord, each person that is watching this, that is struggling with something, I pray that they will realize that you care about that too, and that they will feel your presence and your strength in their life today. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Welcome to our service.
All I once held dear, build my life upon. All this world reveres and wars to all I once thought gain, I have counted loss, spent and worthless now. And I love you, Lord. Now my heart's desire is to know you more, to be found. surpassing gift of righteousness. Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're my best, you're my joy, my righteousness. And I love you, Lord.
Oh, to know the power of your risen life, and to know you in your sufferings, to become like you in your death, my Lord, so with you to live and never die.
Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're my best, you're my joy, my righteousness, and I love you.
Melody that he gave to me within. Have you walked the Blue Ridge Tunnel? Some people call it the Crozet Tunnel. It is a tunnel that's just kind of over there by the mountain. And it's a historic railroad tunnel that has been turned into a walking trail, and it's become really popular. And one of the things that's hard, when you're gonna go walk, parking's gonna be hard, okay? So that just kind of keep that in mind. You can get to it from the Waynesboro side or from the Crozet side. We've always done it from the Crozet side. A part of that is because on the Crozet side, you can park a lot closer to the tunnel. It's only about a half a mile to the tunnel. So you walk along a trail, and it's a nice trail for about half a mile, and then you get to the tunnel. And the tunnel itself is just a little bit less than a mile long. Now it's dark, and it can be a little bit wet. So you take a flashlight, but you can kind of see the down at the far end there. That's where we're going, and you kind of go and you turn around, and we've gone with family, we've gone with friends. It's just kind of a fun thing to do. You know, it's just kind of nice sometimes in life just to go for a walk. And one of the nice things about it is you talk. You kind of got, you know, nothing else to do, so you might as well talk. And I don't know, I like it. And I really believe that you can compare what it means to be a Christian to a walk. That you are, it is about walking with God. I have recently listened to some people that talked about their struggles early in their life when they struggle to understand what does it mean to be a Christian. And so often it is presented as it's being obedient to certain things and believing certain things, that's what Christianity is. And you know, the people that I was listening to, they were disturbed by that. They just felt like this can't be. They almost felt like you got to be perfect, and you got to believe all the right things. And I don't believe that. I don't believe that's what Christianity is. And I believe the Hebrew writer is going to talk to us about that. And I really believe that he presents it in very different terms. So let's look through Hebrews chapter 4. Therefore, since the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us be careful that none of you be found to have fallen short of it. So this rest that he's talking about, he's talking about the rest of God. And that comes from Genesis chapter 2, where God says that when he finished creation, he rested on the seventh day. And he invites us into that rest. Now, that's not the only rest. There's been other times when God has talked about inviting his people into his rest. And he talks about that when that's kind of what he calls it when he was inviting the Israelites to move into Canaan and take the land, particularly in Numbers chapter 13 and 14, which we talked about last week, and we will talk about some this week as well. But you can also see that the rest of God would include heaven. Okay, so it's all of this. And he's saying that this rest, it still stands. God is still inviting his people to walk with him and to live their lives with him. And he calls that rest because it's good. And it's healthy. One of the things about rest in Genesis chapter 2 that I believe is a big part, because God wasn't tired. It's not like he'd been creating and he's like, "Ooh, I'm tired, I gotta rest." Well, I really believe that what God was establishing to us is not just for us to take a day off, okay, which is good, okay, but it is also to don't just work, work, work. Take the time to look back at what you have done and enjoy it. Because that's what God did throughout creation. Throughout creation, he keeps creating things, and he would look at it and say, that's good. It says that God said, let there be light. And God saw that the light was good. And several times during the creation process, it is recorded that God liked it. And I really believe that's part of the rest that he's inviting us into, where we have a much more healthy way of living with him, where we're not just trying to accomplish things. It's not just work, but it is also the enjoyment of being able to sit with God and enjoy his presence and enjoy what he has done with us. So the writer says, be careful that none of you be found to have fallen short of it. The writer is writing this because they were not being careful. That's why he said, be careful. Start being careful. That's what he literally is writing. You know, we saw the same thing in chapter 3, verse 12. See to it, brothers and sisters, that none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. It's the same thing. You're not doing that. You need to do it. Verse 2, for we also have had the good news proclaimed to us just as they did, but the message they heard was of no value to them because they did not share the faith of those who obeyed. Faith. Faith is a key word, not only in the book of Hebrews, but when you talk with God, faith always comes up. In the Word of God, faith matters. And he talks about this gospel that had been preached to them. The gospel that we've talked, the good news. The gospel is that God is good and can be trusted, and that he loves us, and that he has paid for the messes that we have made. He has taken it personally upon himself to make that better and to bring us back to him. And obviously that includes the cross. The cross is the very climax of the gospel. It is the epitome of the gospel. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Without that, the gospel is kind of meaningless to us. God would still be good. God would still, you could still trust him, but there would be no way to get back to him. And that's the cross. But what this writer is saying is meaning the generation that was asked to move into Canaan, they were preached the gospel, but it didn't have effect on them because they didn't share the faith of people who believed. They weren't that kind of people. They had not become people that believed God and trusted him, that no matter what he said, they believed him, which is what was said of Abraham. You know, as Israel approached Canaan, they had been listening to God since Moses. They really, even before that, they had been listening to God. They had been listening to the gospel. And you remember, we've talked about some of the ways that they were hearing from God. The 10 plagues, they saw that. The parting of the Red Sea, they saw that. The destruction of the Egyptian army, that they were so terrified. You know, when they walked out of Egypt, they were all celebrating and they were just all so happy. But then they looked up and here comes the Egyptian army, and they were terrified. And they just thought, this is, we're going to be slaughtered out here. And they did not trust God. They did not believe that God would be able to save them. But God did, and they saw that. And that's the gospel of the saving power of God, the loving saving power of God. They got water from the rock twice, which is the gospel of the provision of God, that God provides for us. Trust him. You can trust him. Manna, quail, and other ways that the gospel was preached to them out in the wilderness. But it says that it had no effect because they did not share faith. They did not share the faith of those who obeyed. They did not have an obedient faith. They'd seen all this, but when the rubber met the road, okay, when it was time for God to say, okay, you've seen all this, I've demonstrated all of this to you, now I need you to, as an act of faith, go with me into the, I will be with there, just like I was with you against Egypt, I was with you in the wilderness, I was with you in every single thing that you have come up against, and I will be with you in this. But they said no, they weren't going to do it, because they weren't living by faith. The disobedience that they showed is the opposite of the faith and love that brings righteousness. Faith brings righteousness. That when you have faith and you walk with God and you trust God and you believe that God is here with you, even then when you can't see Him, when you have that kind of faith, it produces in you righteousness, obedience. But faith is what was missing in Numbers chapter 13. When Caleb and Joshua preached the good news, they basically preached a sermon. And they said, hey, we can do this. Yes, the land is exactly what God said it was. He wasn't lying. He was telling us the truth. It is a beautiful land. It flows with milk and honey. We need to go in it. God will be with us. That's the gospel. That's the gospel they've been hearing out in the wilderness all this time, and it coincided with everything that they had seen and experienced with God. But they didn't listen to that. Their hearts did not connect with that. They weren't living lives of faith, and so they would not obey. It's not really the acts that was missing, it was the faith that was missing. Because later they totally rebelled. They totally rebelled against God. They totally rebelled against Moses and Aaron. They even said, you know, we need to pick new leaders and we need to get back to Egypt. Leave God and Moses and Aaron. They can do whatever they want out here. If they want to be destroyed, fine. But we are taking our children, because we got to take care of our children. We got to take care of our families. It's not right. We can't just destroy our families. That wouldn't be right. And God took great offense that they would say that to Him. But it says they got up the next morning and realized what they had done. And Moses told them, God is livid with you, and you are going to be punished for this. And they sort of acted, they kind of repented and sort of said, oh, okay, we will go into Canaan now. And Moses says, no, you don't understand. God is not just looking for you to obey certain acts. There's not just a thing or two that you need to do, and if you will do that, then everything will be fine. No, God is looking for faith, and it was obvious you don't have faith. And I really believe what God said is, y'all need to go back out into the wilderness. You're going to be out there for 40 years. And you're going to learn what faith is. And the children that you said you couldn't trust me with, they will enter by faith. What was obvious was that they did not have a faith connection with God, a love connection with God. Instead, they're just trying to obey something. And even when Moses said, don't try to go into the land of Canaan now, because God won't be with you and you will not succeed, but they tried anyway and they did not succeed. It was a major defeat and it was a major embarrassment. A life of faith is what God is looking for in us. This faith that He wants. It's interesting to me that as we work our way through this book, the verses that I need are also in this book. Because you can ask the question, well, what are you talking about faith? And we see in this book where it talks about what faith is, this faith that causes obedience in us. And it is our faith that leads us to salvation. Paul talks about this faith. He talks about that it really is faith. He says, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and it's not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." And if I could add to that, which God prepared in advance for us to do with Him through faith. That's what God wants. That's what He didn't get. That's what He's talking about here when He says, "So I declared on oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest." He's talking about the people that wouldn't go into Canaan, that would not live that life of faith. That's what bothered him. And Paul in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 that I just read, "For it is by grace you've been saved through faith." Paul could speak of salvation in the past and our works in the future. Our works are produced by our faith, by our walk with God, by the way that we live and love and worship. Faith is the overriding principle instead of specific acts of obedience. One of the things at this stop is an argument that I hear a lot, and that is, do I have to be baptized? Does a person have to be baptized? I can't stand the argument. I don't like, sometimes my pastor friends will ask me this or other people ask me this, and I just can't stand the argument, because whether I win the argument or lose the argument, it doesn't seem to help. Because what you were asking is, what you should ask is, did God ask us to be baptized? Did God, if you would rather, tell us to be baptized, command us to be baptized? Any of those are fine. Did He? And if He did, then why would we have an argument about whether I have to do it or not? I just don't see the need to argue. Are there commands that God gives us, but yeah, you don't have to do them? And are there commands that, okay, now these commands you got to do. You can't ignore these. You can ignore these, but you can't ignore these. You talk about missing the point. That so grossly misses the point of walking with God and living a life of faith and having a relationship with Him that is based on love and trust, that is called faith. It also stops the notion that all I have to do is be baptized. That is also, in my opinion, that springs from the argument of whether I have to be baptized or not. And sort of setting up different categories of commands. I realize there are certain commands that are more important. I get that. But I just don't believe that there are categories of these you got to do and these you don't have to do. I just don't believe that. And when we sort of argue that with baptism, it's like kind of like if we win the argument, then it seems to lead to the notion that all I have to do is be baptized. And I hear that sometimes. I hear that from people when they talk about other people. Well, they were baptized, and somehow that just makes everything right. You know, baptism is one of the first of a million steps that you take with God. You know, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 1 through 5, Paul talks about the people that the Hebrew writer is also talking about. And he talks about baptism. Now, he's not talking about the baptism that we talk about, but he is comparing walking through the Red Sea to baptism. He says, "For I did not want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud and that they passed through the sea. They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. And nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them. Their bodies were scattered in the wilderness." This is the same story that I've been talking about for like 2 or 3 weeks now. And Paul talks about it here in terms of they experience the baptism, the baptism of God. But it, just like the Hebrew writer says, it really didn't have any effect on them because they wasn't accompanied by faith. Baptism begins a life of faith where we learn to walk with God, and we also learn to listen to His voice. And as we get to know Him, our faith grows, as does our worship of Him and our love of Him. And this sounds so much, makes so much more sense than what I was talking about the people that were struggling with Christianity, particularly earlier in their life, when they just felt like it was a matter of obeying some commandments and believing certain things. This is so much more relational. God has called us to something so much more relational than something technical. You know, in the book of Joshua, you remember in this passage, it says, I told them they're not going to enter my rest. In the book of Joshua, the next generation did enter his rest. And God talks about this. It says, so the Lord gave Israel all the land he had sworn to give their ancestors, and they took possession of it and settled there. The Lord gave them rest on every side, just as he had sworn to their ancestors. Not one of their enemies withstood them. The Lord gave all their enemies into their hands. Not one of all the Lord's good promises to Israel failed. Every one was fulfilled. That's what God had wanted to do with their parents, but their parents said no. And so he waited, and he did it with the children. And As we explore the rest of this book, we're going to see things like one of the things in Hebrews chapter 11, where it talks so much about faith. Now, faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. That's kind of a definition of faith. It's not comprehensive, but that's what faith is. The hope that we have, and one of those hopes is heaven. Okay, that's not our only hope, but that is a hope that we have. But it's confidence in that. By faith, we are confident that there's heaven. So when I say that my dad, who died shortly after we moved here, that my dad is in heaven, that's not wishful thinking. That's not saying, cross your fingers. No, I believe it. I believe it firmly. And I know my dad believed it firmly right before he died too. That's faith. The confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. We don't see God. Is he here? Yes, he is. How do you know that? Well, I'm just crossing my fingers, kind of hoping he's here. No, I know he's here. I know that Jesus Christ is in my life. I know that the Holy Spirit is in my life. I am assured of those things. I don't worry about them. I know them. I take them for granted in a good way. I take them for granted. I am assured of things I don't see. I don't have to see it to believe it. And in that same chapter, God says this through the Holy Spirit, and without faith, it is impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. And when we get to chapter 11, which will be a while from now, but when we get to it, there's all these stories of people that were living by faith, that believed that he exists and knew that he would reward them. And so they were willing to sacrifice and give things up. I want to close by using the example of David to make my point in Psalm 23. Psalm 23 is like the best known psalm that there is. It's used at funerals. It's used all the time. It's a beautiful psalm. But it also illustrates what we're talking about here. The life of faith that David lived. David didn't just obey certain things and believe certain things. David walked with God. Was he perfect? Not even close. If we were to study the life of David, you would see he sinned greatly and he committed big sins. And those were hard on him and they created a mess. But he still walked with God and he would not give that up. And so I want to look at this psalm. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. That's a relationship he's talking about. That's faith and trust. That's what God was asking for of that generation he was going to take into Canaan. He has asked that of every generation since, that whatever it is, wherever it is he's leading us, wherever it is he's taking us, he wants us to trust him and to do it by faith. And he's asking this generation, meaning us, he is asking us of the same thing. He's never stopped asking his people to trust him and to walk by faith. And to don't put your faith in a couple of things that you've done and a couple of things that you believe. Put your faith in him. And he will take care of you. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. God is guiding me. You know, in the Lord's Prayer, Jesus asks for the same thing. Lead us not into temptation. Guide us. And here he's saying, this is what you can expect from God. He does. He guides you. He takes care of you. But verse 4 of 23rd Psalm is one of the favorite parts of the psalm. And so many people can quote what I'm just about to read. But this is the epitome of what faith means. And it's the epitome of what the people that the Hebrew writer is writing about here in chapter 4. It's what they didn't get right. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. The way I learned it growing up, and maybe you did too, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, everybody listening to this has walked through that valley. Did you keep your hand in God's hand? Did you walk by faith? Did you trust that he knew what he was doing and he could get you through this? I promise you, I'm not trying to shame anybody, because Christians throughout the ages have struggled with this. But what David is saying is this is what faith is. That when the rubber meets the road, we stay with God. We trust him. When it looks like we're going to be slaughtered or we're terrified or this is not going to work or God's not going to come through, we trust him anyway. We keep trusting. That's the faith that God wants from us. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You don't run from my enemies. God's not scared of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. God pours blessings into our life. Paul says in Romans that God pours love into our heart. And he also pours blessings into our lives, all kinds of blessings. And it's really worthwhile to stop every now and then and say, let me think about the blessings that I have. And I promise you, you will come up, you will somewhere in the conversation say, you know, wow, my goodness, I had kind of lost sight of how many ways God has blessed me. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That's the assurance of our hope. That's confidence in our hope. And David is saying it. I know that I will dwell in the house of the Lord. When, David? All of your life? No, forever. Forever. This is before Jesus came. This is before the cross. This is before the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He says, David had heard the gospel. David had heard that God was good, that God could be trusted, that God cared for us, that God had, had saving power, and he believed it. That needs to be you and me. We need to walk in this kind of faith. We need to allow God to grow this kind of faith in us. You need this kind of faith. God wants you to have this kind of faith. God is working in your life to give you this kind of faith. I know I've talked about baptism a little bit in here. Please don't misunderstand me. Please don't. Please don't. I'm not saying baptism doesn't matter. I'm not. And I really do believe that God uses baptism as a beginning, as a first step, a very important first step that really does matter. And if you haven't been baptized, I would ask you why. God asks us to be baptized. He tells us, repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. But what I am saying is that is the first of about a million steps that you will take with God. And it is a beautiful life. Don't pull away from that. And so that's what he says from the very beginning. Since the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us be careful that none of you be found to have fallen short of it. Because what we want to hear is not what he said to them, that I declared on oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. No, no. What I want to hear is, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter my rest. Let's bow in prayer. Father, thank you for loving us, being patient with us. Thank you, Father, for giving us a relationship with you that is built on trust and love and worship and your saving power and your provision for us instead of just a few technical things. I love the depth of the relationship that you want with us. May each one of us listening to this today, Father, have the faith that you're looking for in us. Produce it in us, Father. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, I'll trophies down, all down at Jesus' feet. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow.
Dear Christians, when we approach this time of worship, Lord's Supper, the memorial that Christ established himself for us, It helps to remember what is the bread and what is the food of the vine that we are going to partake. The symbolism of bread that Christ makes synonymous to his body is greatly depicted in John chapter 6. That happens right after Christ fed multitudes with physical bread and fish, and he split just a few loaves between thousands of people. That was a miracle. And after that, he has to remind disciples that this bread, this miracle, was important, and yet spiritual bread that he brings to us is much more important to us. When we open chapter 6 in the Gospel of John, and we read in verse 26, Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures the eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you." That's the emphasis of the bread that we're going to partake. That is Christ's spiritual nutrition that he gives us. Continuing to read in verse 48, Christ sums up this meaning. "I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died." So that's the contrast of physical bread. No matter how much of that you have, you're still going to die. And then he continues, "This is the bread that comes down from heaven," that is the spiritual bread, "so that one may eat it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give you for the life of the world is my flesh." That's the symbolism. That's the explanation of what Christ says during the Lord's Supper. "Eat this bread, this is my body." Of course, he meant the spiritual body. That we partake of his spiritual body and he becomes part of us as we ingest him and we become part of him. Let us pray. Dear God, at this point of worship, we ask you to please help us to take this memorial seriously. Help us to concentrate our thoughts and our hearts on Christ. Let him penetrate deeply into us, and us penetrate deeply into him. This is the spiritual bread that is necessary for us, for our eternal life in heaven. In Christ's name we pray to you. Amen. Continuing on with the symbolism, the fruit of the vine, and in other parts of the Bible, Christ is compared to the vine that gives us nutrition. As the blood of the gospel that Christ gives us. And that's again the great spiritual meaning. Continuing on in John 6 in verse 52, we can read, "The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, 'How can this man give us his flesh to eat?' So Jesus said to them, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. And the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father. So whoever feeds on me, he also will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like the bread that fathers ate and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever." This is incredible. And the symbolism should be reminded every week, and that's the reason why we partake the Lord's Supper every week. Let us pray. Dear God, as we partake of this simple bread and simple fruit of the vine, as we open the cup, that is a reminder for us that the blood of Christ is also an important nutrition for us. That is the blood of His gospel, the spiritual food that is necessary for our eternal life. In Christ's name I pray to you. Amen.
I come to the garden.
Thanks for inviting us into your home for this online worship service. We hope that you have been encouraged and blessed by your time with us. Thanks to Alan for a great lesson from the book of Hebrews on a life of faith. We look forward to more lessons in the weeks to come from Alan on the book of Hebrews. We encourage you to stay connected with us through the bulletin, through our website, through Facebook. Also, we do meet face-to-face Sunday morning at 9:30 and 10:30. We have Agape groups Sunday evening. The ladies' class is now meeting Tuesday mornings at 10:30. And we have the teens are meeting on Wednesday nights. So look forward to those face-to-face opportunities if you're able. We pray that you have been encouraged, that you have, through our time together, that you've grown closer to God and seek opportunities to grow closer to those around you. Let's close with a prayer. Almighty and gracious God, we love you so much. We thank you, Father, for blessing us. We thank you, Father, for the opportunities to worship in this even this limited way. We pray that the time will come when we can all be together face to face, and we look forward to that so much. Such a great blessing to be with each other and to share the fellowship of one with another. We pray, Father, that you would bless those that are in need of your healing power. Surround those of us that are struggling with issues, with divisions within our friendships and within our church. We pray that you would bless us with your peace. We would pray that you would grant us your protection from this illness and from the dangers that come our way through this troubled world. We thank you, Father, for the privilege that we have to know one another, to know you, and we pray that we can grow closer to you and closer to one another through fellowship, through times together like this, through times together face to face in our worship service and other times. And we pray that we can be encouraged to love you, to live our life for you. We ask this in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
We will glorify the King of Kings. We will glorify the Lamb. We will glorify the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am. Lord Jehovah reigns in majesty. We will bow before His throne. We will worship Him in righteousness. We will worship Him alone. He is Lord above.